All right, well, Becca, I don't want to burn my eyebrows.
It would have turned on.
Off.
You're not going to burn yourself. It's broken.
I burned my eyebrows off one time. It took 8 months to grow back. Just hold on.
You might have missed the news, but in 2022, a full-fledged Hollywood production team released an esports TV show, and it was amazing. I'm talking, of course, about Players, a mockumentary series created by the team behind American Vandal that tells the story of a fictional LCS franchise seeking their first ever North American title. It's half comedy, half drama, and it's got loads of references to sports documentaries and the world of League of Legends that all came together in what very easily could have been a train wreck, but instead, turned out fantastic.
Listen, bro, you're chill, but if you ever want him to love you like he loves me, you don't go f***ing picking Heimerdinger.
I mean, I would go so far as to say this is my favorite TV series in all of 2022, and today we're going to talk about it because there's a good chance every single person watching this video falls into one of two camps. You either have already seen this show and don't need me to tell you how good it is, or, much more likely, you have never seen or maybe even heard of this series before, because for all of the critical acclaim and awards and good reviews Players keeps on getting, it seems like nobody has watched it. Players has been simultaneously one of the best produced TV shows I think I've ever seen, while also being one of the most poorly marketed. It's a show that could be very entertaining to both League fans and people with no knowledge of esports whatsoever, but I wouldn't blame you if you haven't heard of it, or didn't think it was worth your time when you saw a Reddit thread or tweet announcing its release, because there wasn't enough hype for it. Today, I want to do a deep dive on the show, because I know the creators are trying to get a season 2 greenlit to resolve the season 1 cliffhanger, and with how well the series turned out, they deserve all the love in the world and the right to finish their story. But the only way they can do that is if more people check out the show, which you can watch in its entirety for free on YouTube right now. I will leave links to everything in the description as well as more details at the end of this video for you. But seriously, go watch it. In terms of greatest League of Legends TV series of all time, I would say it's better than Arcane, which I realize is a blasphemous statement, but before you click off this video or leave a dislike, let me explain my reasoning. Just hear me out. Let's talk about why Players is so damn good. Before we get ahead of ourselves, I guess we should begin by going all the way back to the very start of all this. In the early 2010s, writing partners Tony Yacenda and Dan Peralt started a video production company in LA, where they began making some really funny comedies. They made a few shorts, a variety of TV shows, did some ESPN 30 for 30 parodies, but in 2016, they hit their big break when they released a fantastic mockumentary to Netflix called American Vandal. The mockumentary format is something I personally really love. I think it's a fun and creative way to do comedy, taking the serious nature of documentary-style reporting on serious subjects of telling true stories, and then subverting those expectations by talking about made-up stories with ridiculous characters and hilarious scenarios is something we've seen create great comedies year over year. American Vandal found a lot of success as a mockumentary that sort of parodied the true crime documentary. The story follows the aftermath of a high school prank where someone vandalized the school, and immediately the class clown is suspected and expelled, before viewers go on to learn that there's more to the story than meets the eye.
You think about it, dude. He's a foreign exchange student. Who the fuck knows what he's thinking? The Chinese are secretive people.
I'm from Toronto.
After Vandal came out, it immediately became a huge success. It got a second season. At one point, it was ranked as the most binged show on all of Netflix. So now, Tony and Dan are big Hollywood stars. In theory, people are tripping over themselves trying to approach them, writing blank checks to create any kind of show they want. They have all the options in the world, and what do they decide to do next? Make an esports mockumentary about a fictional LCS team.
You know, I don't have regrets. I try and live life without regrets. I mean, sometimes I do wonder what my life would have been like if I hadn't f***ed up that Alistar knockup on the Kog'Maw in 2016.
The show was called Players and released season 1 onto Paramount Plus in late 2022. The premise of the show frames a similar mockumentary format, this time with some parody of sports documentaries, through the lens of following a competitive League of Legends team. A TV crew follows the LCS team Fugitive Gaming and their star support founder Cream Cheese as they try to climb to reach an LCS title in 2021. The team was originally started by Cream and his friends in the mid-2010s when they built built a big brand off of the content they produced and online tournaments they won before managing quick qualification to the LCS. As esports then exploded shortly thereafter, they all thought they had it made in the shade with all the investment that poured into the scene, but things didn't pan out as they had hoped, and now Cream is turning 27, entering the twilight of his career while still seeking his first LCS title.
You want something to drink?
Yeah, I'll just have a car bomb.
There's of course a lot more at play here that I don't want to spoil too many details of, but those are sort of the broad strokes of the overall premise. Additionally, there's a second plotline that runs in parallel surrounding another player named Organism. Originally growing up as a fan of Fugitive, Org eventually started grinding League until he reached top challenger status, becoming a bit of a prodigy AD carry, who then began streaming his high-level gameplay. Even though he was more of an introverted kid that never spoke much, he amassed a huge following interested in his top-level talent, and now Fugitive Gaming have just closed a deal to sign him to be their academy AD carry, a superstar for the future.
You're a prodigy, dude. It's like standing in front of one of those kids who plays the piano, you know? Awesome, dude.
The show plays out as a half-drama, half-comedy, creating jokes that often parody things you'll have seen in traditional sports documentaries, but by the end of the series, you'll find yourself really invested in the fate of Cream, Org, and Fugitive. One of the strongest things the show does really well is use real subjects that actually affect the LCS today as major plot points. Everything ranging from a team owner meddling with roster changes because he's more worried about making money than winning titles.
Honestly, all you care about is money. It's so obvious. The only reason that you're starting this kid is because you think he'd look good in a f***ing Totino's pizza roll commercial.
To Korean imports in NA that have loads of talent, but not the most motivation, happy to look at the region as a rich place to retire to.
Hey, Bob, how you doing? You want anything from inside? All right.
Anyone who's a fan of League will be pleasantly surprised at how real everything feels, in part helped by the fact that so many of these characters are portrayed by real people in the League of Legends scene. Arrow, for example, the Korean LCK champion and North American import, is the guy who plays Fugitive's import mid laner that always needs a bit of extra motivation.
Some of those K-dramas you've been recommending, like Playful Kiss
and Organism and Cream Cheese, to me is starting to feel like Ohani and Baek Sung-jo.
Similarly, Nightfall, who is Fugitive's jungler in the series, is played by Youngbin, a longtime Korean-American pro that's bounced around the LCS, academy, amateur, and collegiate scenes, and he honestly gives some really good performances here.
I think that's the coolest sentence I ever heard, and I heard a lot of sentences before.
There's also a lot of other cameos from real people in the League esports scene that you'll notice if you watch the show. The LCS broadcast crew is the real broadcast crew doing post-game interviews and discussion around Fugitive Gaming. At other times, you'll notice little content creators and other personalities popping up with cameos.
And people keep saying that I should stream Minecraft, but
even just a few episodes in, you should be able to tell how accurate this show is to the professional world of League of Legends today. But sadly, I think the desire to portray esports accurately might have hurt the show, at least in the first few episodes. Early episodes of a TV series already have a lot that they have to do. They have to establish each character that's going to appear, as well as setting up motivations and conflicts, alluding to every storyline and plot theme that's yet to come, while also being entertaining enough to hook the audience into watching the entire thing. But because this show is also about esports and aimed at being something anyone can watch even if you're not a fan of League yourself, that means these early episodes also had to explain what competitive gaming is, League of Legends, and the LCS in a simple enough way a middle-aged Midwesterner could understand it. As a result, if you're a League fan, you'll probably feel like episodes 1 and 2 are the weakest in the series. There's a lot of introduction to the world that you don't need, as well as jokes you might not find as funny about things like goofy champion names.
I like to keep my cool, you know, and like let play out.
Humberdinger! You f***ing kidding?
Episodes 1 and 2 are fine, there isn't anything necessarily wrong with them, but League fans seem to agree they're just the weakest in the series. I would say episodes 3 through 5, though, are where the show really begins to find its stride. I'll stop going in depth on all the details so I don't spoil anything, but this is where Cream Cheese starts coming off as a much more interesting, dynamic character, rather than the cocky jerk he's mostly been so far.
Your wedding video?
Mm-hmm.
I'm smurfing in this one. I really am. My speech is so f***ing good. Can we watch this?
Yeah, let's watch you smurf our wedding.
Side note, shout out to Misha Brooks for his portrayal of Cream Cheese. He does an absolutely killer job acting in this role. When I'm watching him on screen, he's behaving exactly like all of the early esports pros did. I feel like I'm constantly seeing flashbacks to Reginald or Ocelot or any of those early League esports team founders. I think a lot of the accuracy of the show can be credited to Riot and many of the people from the LCS team that actually worked on the show, not just in the form of cameos, but with the actual production. There were many LCS superstars working to help with the writing of each episode, keeping it all true to life. Many LCS names were always on set during filming to help guide direction to be whatever would be most accurate to the real world. And I got to know this because I was one of those people.
He's like the Kawhi Leonard of esports.
There I am, Gary!
Regular viewers of my channel already know this because I've mentioned it a couple of times in earlier videos, but I got to work on players in a couple of different phases during the pre-production, filming, and post-production bits of the show. In pre-production, I was brought on to help gather some gameplay footage from old League matches, providing references for stuff they were looking for relating to gameplay-specific story beats. All the editors didn't really know much about League themselves, so I was initially supposed to assist them on the gameplay front, but then when COVID started shuttering all the live events, the teams couldn't shoot at stuff like the LCS finals, so then I started helping them dig through archival footage of earlier events, creating some believable crowd shots to help with the atmosphere. Then during production, they were kind enough to let me try out for a little cameo role as a talking head on the show.
This was the first time we had seen real synergy between their bot lane. They were finally starting to play to their ceiling.
And finally, when post-production began, I got to help the editors again, now cutting the gameplay footage together into the final cuts of the show. So anytime you see gameplay on screen, that was me. You can either thank me for choosing accurate gameplay clips to map onto screens, or blame me if I didn't direct the editors to cut out any continuity errors. I realize me working on the show kind of makes me a biased party to whether the show was actually good or bad, but I bring it up for two reasons. Firstly, to be honest with you about any sort of disclaimer, but also because it gave me an interesting perspective getting to see how everyone really fell in love with the show from behind the scenes. One of the entire things that got me wanting to make this video is that currently I'm working on a League of Legends documentary on an esports team right now, and over the course of this production, I've been trying to find an answer to a mystery that keeps on popping up. I've interviewed a couple of people in the League space, and nobody's really been able to give me a super straight answer. But eventually, I did a little interview with someone from another esports title, who then told me the answer to this big question I've been pondering for so long, which I don't want to spoil it for you guys. You can watch the documentary if you want to see. But anyway, long story short, the answer to this big mystery I've been trying to solve was an arc in a single episode of Players. Like, I was dumbfounded when I saw this. That means one of two things. Either the production team that made Players were so involved in researching the history of esports that they discovered this crazy narrative from a decade ago in another title and decided to write that in as an arc on one of their episodes, or they were just so in tune to the real world of esports that they accidentally wrote a true event as a fictionalized storyline in their show. I don't think I need to tell you, this is not the kind of attention to detail and care that traditional media has been giving competitive gaming. When they've touched on it in the past, it's mostly been as an object of ridicule. People took the LCS as a joke more than anything. They don't get this involved in learning how the world works. If you take nothing else away from this video, I hope I can at least communicate that this is an unbelievably accurate portrayal of the world of esports. Every single story beat and character is either entirely believable that they could be a real person, or I suspect many of them were modeled after real people in the esports scene or real events that have occurred in the past.
Bro, organism.
Bro, hey, can you take off your headphones?
I'm trying to talk to him. I said bro at a normal volume.
When Players was initially released, it received critical acclaim from basically every review outlet. Currently, season one is sitting with a 94% on Rotten Tomatoes with an 85% audience score. IMDb has it with a 7.3 out of 10 overall, with the last half of episodes getting 9 out of 10s. They recently won an esports award for content series of the year, and every Reddit thread or discussion always sings praises of the show, not just in the League subreddit, but in other places, like the TV subreddit too. I think of everyone I've shown the show to, though, my favorite reaction probably has to be from my parents. Both my parents watched the show as it was being released, and the show's initial release had one episode coming out every week, so I was planning on watching each episode with both of them separately and talking about little details of everything that happened. I started doing this with my mom, and each time we would watch an episode and then talk a little bit after about what my experience was like working on the show. They initially started watching it because I worked on it, obviously. But what was funny was I planned on doing the same thing with my dad, and we did so at first. We watched the first couple episodes and I talked about my experience working on it. But then I had to travel a bit, and while I was gone, he couldn't help himself and he just binged the entire rest of the show without me. I mean, he's a 60-year-old Midwestern father that's never played a video game in his life, and he got so invested in the story of this fictional esports team that now he keeps on texting me like once a week to ask when season 2 is coming out. But sadly, even with all this praise, not enough people are watching it. The television subreddit constantly has people making threads asking why more people aren't talking about this show. Some say it's their favorite show of 2022, praising the acting and everything, but it's always discussion about why aren't more people watching this? I think a big reason the show had such a lukewarm release was because it was originally released on Paramount Plus, the CBS streaming service, which is a newer streaming platform by today's standards, but it was even newer, only just released, when Players first debuted. For most people, they didn't really have a good trailer to go off of. They just had a new show that might be good, might be bad, but it wouldn't be worth it to subscribe to a new streaming service either way. Anyone who did give the first episode or two a shot probably ended up feeling like it wasn't anything special because they got bogged down in all the exposition, slower pace, and more simple jokes. I bet they didn't think that it got this good, but it is good. Oh my god, it's so good, and I really hope we can do something to get this show a season 2 because it absolutely deserves one. At the end of the year, the League of Legends esports page uploaded the entire season 1 to their YouTube channel to watch for free for a limited time only, but there still wasn't really any marketing for it. There was a Reddit thread that was made and some people posted about it to Twitter, but if you missed these posts, you probably missed your chance to watch because now it's been taken down again. But it is still up on YouTube where you can watch it for free right now. At least it's going to be up for the rest of this week, maybe a bit longer, I'm not sure how long. The Funny or Die YouTube page has the whole of season 1 on it, and I want to do a call to arms, go watch it. I am so confident that you will love this show that I will wager your subscription on it. If you go and watch it right now and you make it to episode 5 and you don't finish the rest of the season by then, you can unsubscribe from my YouTube channel. You have my blessing. That is how serious I am about how good the show is and how much I want people to see it. I'll leave a link to all this in the description down below. Leave a like on every episode, watch them, do it fast before they are gone, because at one point they will be privated, just like the ones on the LOL Esports page were. If you want to go above and beyond, you can watch it on Paramount Plus, which you might be able to do for free anyway, and you might want to because the version on YouTube is censored and there's quite a lot of swearing, so there's a lot of bleeps that they had to put in to get around the YouTube guidelines. On Paramount Plus, though, it's completely uncensored and you can watch it for free if you use the free trial. Right now, Paramount Plus is running a thing where you get a 7-day free trial when you sign up for their service. And if this is the only show you want to watch, you can totally watch the first season in 7 days. They aren't that long. It's only 10 episodes. And if Paramount Plus doesn't have anything else you want to watch, you can just cancel before you're charged. I really don't like doing calls to arms like this. I don't enjoy weaponizing my audience to do something that I think should be done. I don't even take sponsorships on my channel anymore, but this is something that really matters to me. I really hope that these guys get a second season, and I know there's a push from inside the show. They just need more people watching it. It feels like a great injustice has been done, and I guess I'm trying to rectify that. You know, I said at the start of this video that I feel like Players is better than Arcane, and I stand by that statement because Arcane was fantastic. And I loved Arcane. It was great, don't get me wrong. But In some ways, creating Arcane was maybe a little bit easier, because while they did have some lore to go off of and some characters already existing in the League of Legends universe, creating Arcane was like creating any sort of fantasy story. You could be as creative and fun as you want without any consequences. If they maybe had some sort of lore discrepancies with how League of Legends lore actually existed, not many people would care. Maybe Necrid would throw a fit about it, but I don't think anyone else would even notice. It's a much bigger challenge to take a community as volatile as the esports community, who has been disrespected by traditional media for decades, and to tell an accurate story about their world. To make fun of the eccentricities of the scene in a way that won't offend anyone while still poking fun at the silly elements of competitive gaming, throwing in serious drama that actually makes you care about esports pros that don't even exist, that's an impossible task that somehow these guys managed to pull off. And the fact that they got it all so accurate, it probably hurt them. People on the internet love to hate watch shows. They love to take a show that's pulling from some sort of source material and hate watch it, pointing out all the little flaws of things they get wrong and dunking on the mistakes made and sharing it all across the internet to a point where it goes viral with how much people hate it. And maybe some people started watching this show expecting to be able to do the same thing, to point out all of the things these guys got wrong. But they didn't get anything wrong, so people just watched the show, quietly enjoyed it, and never shared it beyond that. It's amazing. I mean, this show is amazing. Please give them some love. I really hope they see all the fans that did fall in love with this series, with these characters and the story, and I hope we get a second season. I want to see how this story ends, because it's a really great one.